Welcome to the Crime Club podcast, episode number 2. And in this episode, we will be looking at a tantalizing story of a con operation that lured a businessman to move from Abu Dhabi to India, the ensuing kidnap, and the astonishing rescue operation in the capital of India, New Delhi. Welcome back to the Crime Clock podcast, and this is your host, Kalyan Kumar. Before I begin the story, let me state this in the interest of full disclosure that this podcast has been created with extensive research through the use of websites and reference material, especially the book by Neeraj Kumar, the ex-commissioner of Delhi Police, and the book is titled Dial D for Dawn, Inside Stories of CBI Missions. When Tekat Siddiqui arrived at the Indira Gandhi International Airport in New Delhi, in the wee hours of 11th March 2001, he could hardly contain his excitement. An Abu Dhabi-based entrepreneur, always ready to venture into uncharted territories, he was in the capital on the invitation of one Vijay Rathore, whom he had never met. Claiming to be a prosperous Delhi-based businessman, Vijay had contacted him repeatedly on his mobile phone and through emails, inviting him to Delhi for business negotiations in the export-import of ceramics. The mere thought that he had been sought out by Rathore was enough to make Tekat undertake this journey. As he stepped out of the arrival lounge, he could sense spring in the Delhi air, which was still cool and crisp. The spring in his own step was no less apparent. Vijay Rathore had informed him that he would be received by his secretary Amar, who would be carrying a mobile phone, and had provided the number to Tekat. Tekat then rang up Amar and they decided to meet at the main exit of the airport. Amar informed him that Vijay was waiting for him at his office cum residence. They were soon on their way in a silver Hyundai Accent with Amar at the wheel. Tekat called his wife in Abu Dhabi and informed her of his safe arrival in Delhi, assuring her he would be home soon. Tekat Siddiqui originally hailed from Calicut in Kerala, the very place Vasco da Gama had come for the first time in 1499, and that is how Europe got to know about India. Tekat had shifted to Abu Dhabi about 22 years ago in search of greener pastures. In his mid-40s, wheatish complexion and of medium height, he had an amiable and respectable personality, ideal for the liaison work he did for several companies. He had done reasonably well for himself, but was given to braggadocio or boastfulness about his wealth, unmindful of the unwanted attention that could attract. As it turned out, a Dubai-based gangster had received news of Tekat's boundless riches and plotted to have him abducted during his visit to India, aware that such adventurism in the Gulf was foolhardy to attempt. The gangster had enough connections in India to implement his plans. As the Hyundai Accent sped through Delhi's chaotic traffic, Tekat was lost in his thoughts. So deep were his reveries that neither the city's notorious smog nor the boorish driving of Delhi's motorists made any impression on him. As Delhi's landscape whizzed past by, snapshots of his own life flashed in his mind. He pinched himself to remember the gifts he had planned to buy for his dear wife. Half an hour later, the accident came to a halt outside a well-appointed bungalow in a posh South Delhi colony. Thacket was smiling to himself when he walked onto the premises, hoping that the soil of Delhi would catapult his financial fortunes and his life would change forever. As he neared the entrance, he expected he would soon be shaking hands with Tony businessmen in well-cut dark suits and designer ties, and of course, wearing very broad smiles. But hopes often slip away like quicksilver. Once inside the bungalow, he came face to face with a bunch of shabbily dressed and unkempt men. It not only seemed that they had never smiled in their lives, but from their hostile stares, it also appeared to Thacket that talking business was the last thing on their minds. There was no customary exchange of greetings either. As hope vanished and fear grew, things happened in a blur. Very soon, they did make him sit, but in an odd way, pushing him roughly towards a chair. Almost immediately after, there was much slapping and shoving, and then a torrent of blistering underworld invective came his way, most of which sounded very alien to his rapidly reddening ears. Instead of feeling welcome and relaxing with a set of friendly business counterparts, Thacket was now trembling before a bunch of dangerous abductors, one of whom was pointing a handgun straight at him. Would he see his family again? Would the abductors make him disappear? Would they torture him endlessly? As his mind was caught in a whirl of unwanted thoughts, his body began to stiffen with fear and his muscles started paining from the generous thrashing he had received. Thacket wondered why he had not done any background checks before taking the flight to Delhi. But it was too late now. The captive was informed that a ransom of $2 million, which is 12 crore Indian rupees, would have to be paid if he wanted to be set free. Thacket was quick to realize that the exaggerated bluster about his affluence was coming home to roost. When he said he didn't have the kind of money, he was beaten even more mercilessly. He was made to speak to his wife in Abu Dhabi and notify her of his abduction and the ransom demand for his release. Within minutes, Thacket's life and the lives of his family members had gone topsy-turvy. The castles he had built in the air came crashing down. On 12th March, the day following the kidnapping, Thacket's distraught family members met KC Singh, India's ambassador in Abu Dhabi, seeking his help. The ambassador promptly took a written complaint from the victim's wife and faxed it to R.K. Raghavan, the then director, CBI. CBI, by the way, is the India's equivalent of FBI, but not on steroids. March 2001 was a Monday and a hectic week lay ahead for Neeraj Kumar, a 1976 batch IPS or Indian Police Service officer who was promoted to the rank of Deputy Inspector General of Police in 1993. After which, he proceeded on deputation to the Central Bureau of Investigation, CBI, where he served until 2002. The thrill of an enjoyable round of golf the previous day was still fresh in his mind. But the days ahead had thrills of a different order in store for him that not even golf could match. Soon after he reached office, he received a call from Abu Dhabi. Ambassador Singh was on the line. The ambassador gave Kumar the details of the incident as reported to him and informed Kumar that he had directed two close relatives of Siddiqui, one of whom was a retired police officer from Kerala himself, to reach New Delhi and meet Neeraj Kumar. Ambassador K.C. Singh and Neeraj Kumar had known each other for nearly a decade. In the mid-1990s, Singh was a joint secretary, counselor, passport and visa section in the Ministry of External Affairs, while Neeraj was handling the Mumbai blast case. They met frequently then in connection with the official work. Neeraj Kumar always found Singh very responsive and positive to his requirements, and the feeling was reciprocated too. Thekkat Siddiqui's relatives met Neeraj Kumar on 15th March, 4 days after the kidnap, and narrated the kidnap story. The enormity of the crime dawned on Kumar with all of its transnational dimensions. It was a live kidnap situation with a non-resident Indian's life hanging tenuously by a thread. The ransom calls were being received overseas while the hostage was somewhere in India, though not necessarily in New Delhi. Since a satellite phone was being used to call Thekkat's family members, Kumar could not rule out the possibility of Thekkat having been taken out of Delhi. Kumar was not too sure how to respond. The CBI, its sterling reputation notwithstanding, was not equipped to handle such cases. Adept at dealing with cases of corruption and economic crimes, its capabilities in tackling a live kidnap situation had never been tested. It was a job cut out for the local police or one of their specialized units like the crime branch or the special cell anti-terrorism squad. Following the ambassador's call, the options before Kumar were to either direct Thekkat's relative to the Delhi police, refer them to the special crimes division of the CBI, or to take up the case in one of his own branches in the economic offences wing of the CBI, of which he was then the joint director. The last option was the most tempting, but was fraught with inherent risks. At the same time, he was conscious of the faith reposed in him by India's ambassador in Abu Dhabi, whom he was loath to disappoint. Also, the case involved rescuing an NRI, and it had the potential for providing a fair amount of adrenaline rush, thrills, and adventure which every police officer craves, or should crave, if he's worth his salt. At this stage, it's important to mention that the CBI has three divisions: the Anti-Corruption Division, the Economic Offences Wing, and the Special Crimes Division. Cases of murder, robbery, and kidnappings are usually investigated by the last, which has branches located in different parts of the country, just as the other two divisions do. As already mentioned, the CBI undertaking a case that involved a live hostage situation requiring search and rescue operations was unheard of. Volunteering to investigate such a case, and that too a branch of the Economic Offences Wing, was sticking one's neck out a bit too far. His career's track record thus far had earned him ample laurels and medallions. He had had the privilege of leading investigations into sensational crimes, often involving the underworld. Then why was he racked by worries and imaginary fears instead of just going ahead with this case? At the same time, why take it up and risk his own reputation along with that of the CBI? If things did not fall into place, the consequences could be enormous. The media would run him down for years, as would his own colleagues. He was coveting the excitement of action, but couldn't throw prudence and discretion out of the window. He was still mulling over the details given by Siddiqui's relatives and the strange dilemma he was in, when, by happy coincidence, Rajbir Singh, an assistant commissioner of Delhi Police, special cell walked into his office. Rajbir had worked with him in the Delhi police when he was the DCP of South Delhi district and was well known for his detective and operational skills. Earlier, too, Kumar had coordinated with him and his team on several operations undertaken by Kumar in the CBI, and they had always come up trumps. Kumar asked for Rajbir's opinion on what he should do after sharing with Rajbir all the available details of the case. His opinion was unequivocal. Such challenging cases should not be allowed to go elsewhere. He also expressed his keenness to be associated with the investigation if at all Kumar decided to take it up. From providing technical support to armed backup, he would be an invaluable partner in a case such as this. He had a crack team under him, comprising tried and trusted go-getters, which he offered to place at Kumar's disposal, along with his own services and expertise. His immediate superiors in the Delhi police, DCP Ashok Chand and Special Commissioner S. Ramakrishnan, had always given Rajbir carte blanche where corroborating with Kumar was concerned. Whatever little doubt lurked in Kumar's mind vanished. He rushed to P.C. Sharma, then Special Director and his immediate superior, and brought the matter to his notice. P.C. Sharma, who is actually related to me distantly, was absolutely clear that they should indeed take up this case in one of their branches in the Economic Offences Wing and investigate it. He was sure that, like several other operations undertaken in the EOW during Kumar's tenure, they would succeed again. His confidence in Kumar was inspiring, and Kumar became determined to rise to his expectations one more time. The first and foremost job was to get the director to assign this case to Kumar, which in the normal course of events would have gone to a special crimes unit. P.C. Sharma immediately got that done, and the facts sent by the ambassador in the UAE to the director reached Kumar's desk within minutes. But to Kumar's horror, the two relatives who had come to liaise with them did not want the case to be registered formally. Perhaps they didn't wish to go through the full run of the Indian legal system. Their desire was to secure Thacker's release without getting into legal formalities. This, coming from a man who was a former police officer himself, was particularly distressing to Kumar. However, Kumar's position was very clear. A complaint had been received from their ambassador, and they had no option but to re-register a case. Eventually, a case of abduction for ransom with threat to cause death, which is Section 364A of the IPC, that is Indian Penal Code, and criminal conspiracy, Section 120B IPC, was registered on 16th March and investigation formally taken up 5 days after the abduction. The joint operation of the CBI and the special cell of the Delhi police to rescue Thacker Siddiqui was codenamed Operation Desert Safari. Five days after Thacker had been abducted, Kumar's mobile phone rang late in the evening. It was Siddiqui's elder brother, Ahmed Koya. Thacker had been made to speak to him by the kidnappers to disclose the ransom amount. During the conversation, Thacker had managed to speak a few words in his mother tongue, Malayalam. He had cleverly managed to slip in a few stray and incoherent bits of information while talking to his brother. He was being held hostage on the second floor of a building in the vicinity of a shop with phone number 6683899. Also, he could hear aircraft flying right over his head all the time, and a public telephone booth was located close by. Kumar immediately rang up 197, the public phone inquiry number, to ascertain the address where a phone with the number 6683899 was installed. Kumar was informed that it was F73 Begumpur, Malviya Nagar. In fact, it was a place I worked and stayed for quite some time. Kumar shared this information with ACP Rajbir Singh and asked him where the two of them could meet to follow up on the lead. Rajbir asked Kumar to stay at home while he, Rajbir, took up the preliminary fieldwork. Shortly after midnight, Rajbir called. He sounded terribly excited. He had located not only the shop but also a house close by which matched the description given to Koya by Thicket. They decided to meet at Essex Farms, a commercial banquet hall near the Indian Institute of Technology, Delhi. Kumar informed Ramnish, the investigating officer, and Hitesh Awasthi, Kumar's DIG in the CBI, and asked them to reach the rendezvous point immediately. Kumar's wife saw him take his 22-bore Walther PPK pistol out of his cupboard and knew something big and dangerous was on. It was perhaps the first time during his tenure in the CBI that she had seen him leaving home armed. That too past midnight. Ordinarily, if he were serving in the Delhi police in the same rank, he would have over 1,000 men to fall back on. But in his current assignment, things were different. The CBI is a perpetually understaffed and a lean organization. Most things are best done yourself, hands-on. In the bargain, you learn a lot, but at times it can land you in situations you're not used to. So here he was, leaving home past midnight with only his pistol for company. Like any concerned spouse, his wife too was worried and asked him to be careful. There was no time to wait for his official vehicle to arrive, so he left in his private car, driving himself. When he reached Essex Farms, the rendezvous point, Rajbir was already there with about 20 of his best team members, including Inspector Mohan Chand Sharma, his right-hand man in the special cell. The enthusiasm and motivation of Rajbir's men had to be seen to be believed. Wearing bulletproof jackets and armed to the teeth with AKs and semi-automatics, they presented a picture of determination and supreme confidence. They also carried powerful torches and a long ladder. The body language of the boys was electric and inspiring. Begumpur is one of the many urbanized villages of Delhi. It is on the erstwhile agricultural land of such villages that posh residential colonies in India's capital city have come up. Most high-end colonies in the city, therefore, are invariably juxtaposed with such villages, which themselves have grown in a most unplanned and haphazard manner. Houses are both pakka, meaning solid and permanent, and semi-pakka, with poor municipal amenities of sewerage and roads. The village residents have retained their old lifestyle. It is fascinating to see old men sitting on carts outside their homes wearing traditional clothes with safas, that is head wraps, with smoking hookahs, which is a pipe for smoking tobacco, while the women folk veiled in dupattas, that is scarves, pass by. Cows and buffaloes wave for space with automobiles and two-wheelers in the narrow lanes. Every village has a head, usually called a pradhan, whose writ runs large in the village. The residents retain their earthy ways, struggling to keep urban modernity at arm's length. Such rural settings are usually less than 50 meters away from tawny colonies that the BMWs and Mercedes of the super-rich generally flit in and out of. Begumpur, one such village, sits between Sarvodaya Enclave and Sarvapri Vihar, both posh residential colonies. A few beautiful historic monuments, largely lying uncared for and decaying by the day, dot the area, seemingly amused with the changing times. Rajbir had thought it wise to wake up Inspector Rajendra Bakshi of the Delhi Police, and this person in fact was my ex-landlord once, who happened to be a resident of Begumpur. Inspector Bakshi, an ace investigator in his own right, had in turn contacted the local Pradhan and sought his help. While carrying out any police operation in Delhi's urbanized villages, it is always advisable to take a local authority along as a facilitator. It makes things easier and safer. Inspector Bakshi and the Pradhan were waiting for Rajbir and Kumar when they reached Begumpur, approaching it from the Aurobindo Marg end, across Sarvodaya Enclave, a colony located to the west, overlapping the village. The Pradhan informed them that he knew of the premises Rajbir had located, which belonged to an exporter of garments and handicrafts. He also knew that the exporter had regular business dealings with Dubai and had several people from Gulf visiting him from time to time. Some of them, according to him, looked suspicious. This only strengthened Kumar's team's conviction that they were on the right track. The Begumpur house had a huge courtyard at the back. There was no way to reach its second floor from there, even if they used the ladder they were carrying. This left them with no option but to raid it from the front. The front door was solid teak, and breaking it open would only harm the inmates and neighbors alike. On Kumar's request, the Pradhan rang the doorbell while they hid themselves. First, the lights on the first floor came on. A Nepali servant peeped out and spoke to the Pradhan. Despite requests from the Pradhan, he refused to open the door and switched off the lights. Then the lights on the second floor came on and they heard a flurry of activity. They knew that the time to move in had arrived and broke open the front teak door. What had looked impregnable was gone in seconds. Homes are meant to be your castles, unless the cops are at the gates and decide to barge in. They rushed in and scrambled up the stairs. But to their utter disappointment, all they found on the first and second floors were frightened laborers hailing from Nepal. It came to light that the caretaker who had earlier spoken with the Pradhan was scared to open the door because he had allowed a handful of fellow Nepalis to stay on the premises. This was not in the knowledge of his employer, who also owned the building. Thus, their first raid had proved futile, even though the Begumpur house entirely matched the description given by the victim. They continued to scour the area, checking house after house, while planes kept flying overhead, reminding them that they were close, but not quite there. In most houses that they checked, young students preparing for the entrance exams of the coveted IITs were staying as paying guests. They were rudely woken up by past midnight knocks of the police. They decided to call off the search at the break of first light, sleepless and disappointed, unable to comprehend why they could not reach their target despite seemingly specific and reasonable pinpointed leads and intel. Once home, Kumar tried to snatch a wink or two, but to no avail. He worried endlessly for the man who was being held hostage by desperate transnational criminals. At the same time, it must be admitted, he fretted for his own reputation, which he felt was in grave jeopardy. He asked himself, "Have I, on this occasion, bitten more than I could chew?" In case anything went wrong and the abducted man was found killed somewhere, would it not bring a bad name to the CBI and to him? Imaginary fears had begun to get the better of him. Ahmed Koya called him at about 11 the same morning. Thekkett had been made to speak to his family again by the kidnappers, and in the course of the conversation had slipped in more clues. White plastic flower pots and green net on the terrace of the premises where he was being held. Some clothes had been kept out in the open to dry. A couple of mosques with their round domes were visible in the vicinity. Ahmed Koya made it very clear to Kumar that his brother was under tremendous duress. Whatever his kidnapped brother was conveying to him was quite garbled, and whatever Koya was telling Neeraj was based on what he could make out of their conversation. In the meanwhile, Koya played for time with the kidnappers. Considering that it would not be proper to bother the Delhi police boys who had been up all night, Kumar decided to set off on his own. He mainly concentrated on the Sarvodaya enclave area, where he found that every other flat seemed to match most of the description given by the hostel. If it had flower pots, the green net was not inside. If both were present, there was no dome-like structure nearby. Exasperated, Kumar reached the residence of Inspector Rajendra Bakshi, the Begumpur resident who had helped them the previous night, and sought his help. He immediately came with him, and they searched many flats in Sarvodaya enclave and Begumpur with the help of local property dealers, but to no avail. Meanwhile, they had commenced work on the technical aspects of the case. They had managed to get Thekkat's international roaming mobile number from his family, who, on the request of the police, had got a printout of the calls made and received by this number from the UAE's mobile service provider. The analysis of the call log showed that it had been in touch with a satellite phone number starting with 00873767. Thekkat's telephone book in Abu Dhabi showed this number in the name of Vijay Rathod of Delhi. Enquiries made with the mobile service providers in Delhi showed that Thekkat, on reaching Delhi, had called a Delhi mobile number starting with 98101. Location parameters of both the numbers on the morning of 11th March, at the time Thekkat's flight arrived in Delhi, indicated their location to be around IGI airport. The CBI analyzed the call detail of the Delhi mobile phone and took it under interception. They found that the user was in touch with a girl in Vasant Kunj and attempting to fix a date with her soon. Further analysis of these mobile numbers and other connected numbers that figured in their call details revealed that the user 98101 was also using two other mobile numbers, 981020 and 981002. Thus, the concerned gangster had three mobile handsets with different IMEI numbers. One more IMEI number appeared on the call details of mobile 98101. The most significant finding was that the location parameters of 98101 show that it was constantly in and around Begumpur, the area in which the CBI was desperately hunting for the kidnappers and their victim. To some extent, it reassured them that they were on the right track. The special cell boys, who had earlier investigated a kidnapping case in which one MC Mahajan of Desh Bandhu Gupta Road had been abducted on 23rd November 2000, were able to connect that one of the same IMEI number had been used in that kidnapping as well. Mahajan had subsequently been rescued and 8 kidnappers arrested. They were all from Uttar Pradesh. The gangster using the mobile had been identified as Virendra Pant, also known as Chotu, a dreaded underworld criminal who was a close associate of Bablu Srivastava, a mafia don from UP, a northern state of India. The interception of Pant's telephones in the Mahajan case had revealed that he had been calling Abu Salim under the code name Rathod. The name Vijay had also been used in that case. Abu Salim was another gangster who at that time was based in Dubai. The CBI were now more or less certain that Thekkat Siddiqui was in the hands of Virendra Pant, who usually operated in tandem with his close associate Sanjay Khanna, also known as Chunky. Virendra Pant belonged to a respected family from Himachal Pradesh. He had studied at Rai University in Haryana. Although a keen sportsman, bad company had brought him into crime. He was young, handsome and sophisticated, fluent in both Hindi and English. His inseparable partner in crime was Chunky, who belonged to a decent South Delhi family that owned a sprawling bungalow in Safdarjung development area. Chunky was equally presentable and glib. The duo made a formidable pair of kidnappers who usually carried out hatchet jobs for more senior criminals. They and their gang had the expertise and the gumption to abduct wealthy persons in urban settings and extort huge sums of money. Given their suave and presentable personas, they could operate in cities with considerable ease and facility. Killing hostages, if the ransom was not paid, was part of their modus operandi. They had committed several kidnappings in the past for Bablu Srivastav, Abu Salem, Fazl Ur Rahman, Ali Budesh, Aftab Ansari, etc. in different big cities in India like Delhi, Kolkata, Mumbai, Lucknow, and so on. These revelations were cause for further worry. Was it now necessary and prudent for Kumar to request the Commissioner of Police, Delhi, to put the entire might of the Delhi police behind this case so that the kidnapped person could be rescued and his precious life saved? He was also beginning to ask himself why he had allowed the advice of a maverick ACP and taken up the investigation of a kidnapping case involving a rescue operation. After all, he was in the CBI, a joint director handling economic offences. What business did he have getting involved in a case of kidnapping with hardly any resources of his own to handle such an operation? If anything went wrong, no fingers would be pointed at the ACP or the Delhi police. The entire blame would lie at his door and that of the CBI's. Meanwhile, quite understandably, the tone and tenor of Koya's calls from Abu Dhabi kept changing for the worse. He was gradually sounding aggressive and reproachful. He said he had committed a grave error by reporting the matter to the Indian police, the CBI included, who in any case are not known to be professionally competent and efficient. If any harm came to his brother, the entire responsibility would be Kumar's. On 17th March, 6 days after his brother was kidnapped, he disclosed that his family had negotiated the ransom amount and decided to pay $700,000, which is slightly over 4 crore of rupees in Indian currency. And the payment was to be made the following day and get his brother released and be done with it. When all of Kumar and his team's efforts to trace Thekkit drew a blank till late that night, Kumar decided to talk it over with Rajbir and tell him about his assessment of the situation. Rajbir was quick to sense Kumar's serious apprehension and did his bit to assuage them. Rajbir reminded him that one of the gang members was already on the radar and was going to meet his Vasantkuch girlfriend soon. If nothing else worked, Rajbir said, they could easily pick him up at a time of their choosing and extract the details of the place where the hostage was being kept. Rajbir's sense of confidence and calm did its bit to make Kumar think positively. Kumar returned home, a trifle reassured, yet restless and apprehensive. An early morning call the following day from Koya, reiterating his family's decision to pay $700,000, jolted Kumar out of bed. As per the deal with the kidnappers, Koya was to travel to Dubai in the afternoon to deliver the ransom amount to the money changer deputed by the abductors to be the recipient of the booty. There was no way Kumar could dissuade him from doing so. Kumar told him he was free to proceed to Dubai from Abu Dhabi, but suggested that he check with Kumar once before delivering the money in case there had been some development at their end by then. Koya mockingly told Kumar he had lost all hope and that enough was enough. How could Kumar convince Koya that not only was he totally empathetic with every member of the Siddiqui's family, but almost equally concerned about Thekkit's well-being as well? More importantly, Kumar was anxious to rescue Thekkit from the clutches of the kidnappers at the earliest. It was 18th March 2001, a Sunday, but certainly not a day to laze around at home or play golf. Bundle of nerves that he was, Kumar once again set out on his own looking for the elusive flat. He thought of checking out Ajjini village in South Delhi, where he had seen mosques with domes while conducting an operation in 1995, which had led to the arrest of Jagtar Singh Tara, the first accused to be apprehended in the sensational assassination of Sardar Bien Singh, the then Chief Minister of Punjab, and a story for a later podcast. Kumar drove through the village slowly, looking around, but in vain. He proceeded towards Shivalik, another South Delhi colony. Both Ajjini and Shivalik are in close proximity of Begumpur, and many flats there matched quite a few clues the hostage had given. Both localities lie in the air funnel, with planes flying overhead frequently. Ruins of mosque-like structures, as mentioned by the hostage, were plenty in their vicinity. In almost sheer desperation, Kumar parked his car and scoured the entire neighborhood on foot, including Sadhana enclave, again located in that general area. Several two-storied flats overlooked the dome-shaped structures, and quite a few of them had flower pots on their terraces. But some other vital details, like the presence of a green net or a telephone booth nearby, were missing. His anxiety was rising by the minute. He decided to drive to the Lodhi colony office of the special cell to meet up with Rajbir and take fresh stock of the situation. He found two other officers of the Delhi police present there, Inspector Rajendra Bakshi of the crime branch and Inspector Harcharan Verma, then posted as a station house officer or SHO, the man in charge of a police station in South Delhi. Both of them were assisting the CBI without keeping their superiors informed. They were doing so purely out of their goodwill for Rajbir and respect for Neeraj. Had they sought the permission of their superiors, it would never have been given. For a local police force to get involved with the CBI, several formalities must be fulfilled. The CBI must share all the details of the case and make a formal request, which must be approved by the police chief. Where was the time for all of this? Involving more people meant greater risk of information leaking to the media and so on. Kumar once again impressed upon them that it was time to involve the Delhi police and get the local police and police control room vans to conduct house-to-house searches in the area. This had become imperative, he felt, as they were getting nowhere. If anything were to go wrong, they would be blamed for keeping all the information to themselves and not involving the Delhi police sooner to widen the scope of the searches. Rajbir and the other two officers present were opposed to the idea. Verma said that the police station staff and the police control room vans would not handle the searches with the finesse that was required. Their ham-handedness would only expose the hostage to risks that could prove fatal. They reassured Kumar once again that they were on the right track and the best thing to do was to press ahead patiently. Kumar returned home for lunch, still edgy and knotted up with the gravity of the situation. He got another call from Koya that his brother had been made to speak to him once again, maybe for the last time. The kidnappers had decided that enough was enough and were taking him out of the safe house where he was being held captive thus far. They would drive him in the general direction of the airport. In case the ransom was paid in Dubai, as had been mutually agreed, ticket would be dropped at the airport and his passport returned. Adequate money would be given to him for his ticket and incidental expenses. But if the ransom money was not paid, he would be shot and his body thrown on the roadside in a remote area. Koya added that Tekit was sobbing during the conversation, but once again had managed to convey a few clues about his location. A wedding ceremony was underway in close proximity of the kidnappers' hideout. Loud music could be heard from the venue. A car with a canvas cover was parked across the street. A red colored multi-storied building was also in view from where he was confined. Kumar quickly passed on the information to Rajbir, who in turn informed the search teams already combing the area. One of these teams spotted a marriage function in progress in a park in Sarpre, Bihar. Loud music too was playing at the location. One thing was clear. While Kumar and his team had focused their searches on the Begumpur and Sarvodaya enclave areas, the captive was being held hostage in all probability in adjacent Sarpre, Bihar. The clue given by the hostage about the landline number had kept them going around Begumpur and Sarvodaya enclave, ignoring Sarpre, Bihar altogether. Rajbir informed Kumar of the development and they decided to meet at the House Khas Police Colony located on Outer Ring Road close to the IIT crossing. Sarpre, Bihar was only a stone's throw away from there. They gathered at the meeting point in no time. It was about 4:30 in the afternoon. They left in unmarked cars for Sarpre, Bihar and regrouped again in a park. Their presence aroused the suspicion of few watchmen of the colony. It was broad daylight and it was most unusual for them to find strangers in such numbers talking animatedly to each other. One thing was clear. The hiding place, taking into account the latest clues, was in Sarpre, Bihar and not in Begumpur. But the million-dollar question was, where in Sarpre, Bihar? It's a fairly large colony with hundreds of houses located cheek by jowl. There was no option but to check each house in every lane to see which one fully matched the description given by the hostage. They were closer to their destination, but just not there. Kumar took Rajbir aside and discussed with him the plan he had in mind. Every member of the team needed to be reminded once again what they were looking for. All clues received from the hostage had to be reiterated to everyone. Given that they were out in broad daylight, they had to do their best to remain as inconspicuous as possible. The only way to do so was to walk in ones and twos. Since flats in every lane had to be checked out for the clues, it was decided that one person would approach a lane from one end and the second from the other end. In case anyone found something of interest, he would call Rajbir on his mobile, who in turn would inform Kumar. They would all meet at a spot closest to the premises identified and collectively decide their next move. Kumar made it amply clear that in case they decided to raid a certain building or apartment, the final go-ahead would be given by Kumar himself. A brief pep talk to the boys pumped them up. Even though Kumar was technically not their boss, they all knew that it was, at the end of the day, his operation and they were working to assist him. They all knew him, as he had served in the Delhi police for long and was not exactly an unpopular officer in the rank and file. Also, they had worked together on a couple of operations earlier and met with success. Like men possessed, more than 20 of them scattered in predetermined directions. Since it was a Sunday, most men folk in Sarpre, Bihar were at home watching TV or catching 40 wings. The lanes and bylanes were practically deserted. Every now and then, people would step out of their apartments and eye them with suspicion. The time at their disposal was limited before somebody called up the police control room and siren wailing vans converged on the spot, ruining everything. They were drawing a complete blank. No flat seemed to fully match the description. Word was spreading in the colony that some strangers were on the prowl. They were beginning to lose heart when, out of sheer despair, Kumar broke away from the main team and went about 50 yards or so eastwards. Suddenly, another row of houses, which they had failed to notice hitherto in their determination to keep close to the marriage venue, emerged before him as a mirage would in the distant horizons of a desert. As he took a few steps into the lane, he noticed a green net on a rooftop, and below it were rows of white flower pots with beautiful roses in full bloom. A car covered with a canvas sheet was parked opposite this house. The red-colored multi-storied building mentioned by Thicket also stood to the east from where he had entered the lane. And of course, the marriage venue and the dome-shaped monuments were all there. As he walked down this lane, he was seized by a sensation that is hard to describe. Whether it arose out of too much fatigue and stress or over-obsession, he didn't know. He had felt a similar sensation on earlier occasions too, when nearing the successful culmination of a difficult and complicated operation. Sometimes he had wondered whether it is something supernatural or some kind of message from the above. Countless thoughts reverberated in his mind. Is this going to be another successful operation? Is this the turning point? He saw Sub-Inspector Mehtab Singh, a young officer of the special cell, walk down the lane from the other side, and the two of them met almost halfway, close to the house with a green net on its terrace. They exchanged looks, and Kumar pointed out to him all that he had observed. Almost simultaneously, Rajbir emerged at the far end of the lane. On being shown the telltale signs, he began to shake Kumar by his hand, congratulating him for completing the mission. Kumar told him to remain focused on the job at hand till it was actually over with. At this moment, he noticed a dhobi, that is a washerman, encrossed in ironing clothes. He had been watching them all that time, even though he pretended to be oblivious. Police instinct guided Kumar to him, and he asked the dhobi if he knew any abnormal activity in the house with the green net. But the dhobi feigned complete ignorance. Judging by his speech, Kumar could tell that the dhobi was from Bihar, a state in the eastern part of India. Kumar was quick to take advantage of that and told the dhobi that he himself was a police officer from Bihar and was trying to rescue someone who was being held hostage. A bit reassured, the dhobi reluctantly told them that the house they should look at was not the one with the green net, but the one next to it. On the top floor lived several young men who were usually up to no good. Immediately, Rajbir led a group of his best men up the staircase of the house, which was 1x/22, Sarpri Vihar. Another team surrounded the whole area. Moments later, there was a sound of a rapid gunfire, and almost simultaneously a scream and a loud thud was heard. Someone had rushed out and jumped into the stairwell of the adjoining house. There was more gunfire. A couple appeared on the balcony of the adjoining house with a wailing child, pleading to be evacuated. Kumar had a tough time pacifying them and assuring them that they had nothing to worry about. A crowd had begun to gather at both ends of the lane, and the balconies and terraces of the buildings around were filled with people with grim and scared faces. The gun battle slowly abated. Kumar suddenly saw Thicket Siddiqui appear on the terrace with two special cell officers who soon brought him down. He was in tears, in a state of total disbelief and shock. Kumar introduced himself and dialed Koya's number from his mobile. Expectedly, there was untold relief and jubilation at the other end. Everyone in Thicket's family spoke to Kumar, expressing gratitude. Koya apologized for having been rude and impatient with him. Koya was full of praise for the CBI and the Delhi police for what they had done. When Thicket recovered control of his senses, he informed the CBI and Delhi police team that two of his tormentors had left in a car shortly before they had arrived. Amar, the person who had received him at the airport, had gone to see off an accomplice at the railway station. Quite incredibly, just then, a car drove into the lane where they stood, unmindful of the crowd that had gathered. Thicket shouted that it was the same car. Some of the team ran and caught the man on the wheel. He identified himself as Rakesh Saraha, and the person whom he had seen off was Santosh Acharya, a notorious gangster of Mumbai belonging to the Fazlu Ali Budesh gang. Rajbir took Kumar upstairs where two gangsters lay dead with their weapons beside them. They were none other than Virendra Pant, also known as Chotu, and Sanjay Khanna, also known as Chunky. The man whose body was found in the stable was later identified as Sunil Nathani, who had no criminal record. It was unfortunate that he and two of his friends, Karthik and Vipin Chaudhary, had unwittingly got mixed up with this gang of kidnappers. They all belonged to respectable families. This had perhaps happened because they had befriended Rakesh Saraha, ignorant of his criminal antecedents. It was Rakesh who, on Virendra Pant's behest, had approached Karthik and Vipin seeking permission to use their flat for a few days to keep a kidnapped person. They had gone along with him for reasons best known to them. All through Thicket's captivity, they had known what was going on but had decided to look the other way despite Thicket's pleas for help. They were charged later with and convicted for conspiracy to commit the crime and abetment. Neeraj Kumar informed Special Director P.C. Sharma, who immediately arrived at the spot and patted all of them on their backs. He was extremely delighted at the success, but not unduly surprised. Such was his faith in Kumar and his team. It was this supreme confidence in their ability and his unique, non-interfering and encouraging leadership style which had played a crucial role in the success of this operation. Their work, however, was not over yet. They immediately obtained details of the train, the coach and seat number of Santosh Acharya from Rakesh Saraha and passed them on to D. Shivanandan, Kumar's batchmate from the Mumbai branch of the CBI. Famous for his exploits against the Mumbai underworld in his earlier capacity as JCP Crime, Shiva was on the job straight away. In a joint operation with the Mumbai police, Acharya was caught when the August Kranti rolled into Mumbai Central the following morning. The joint team had boarded the train at one of the earlier stations, Vapi, spotted their man and kept him secured until the train reached Mumbai. Kumar and his team quickly raided B6X South Extension Part 2, another hideout of the kidnappers, on Saraha's lead. This was where Thicket had been driven on his arrival in Delhi and detained after being assaulted. Some important evidence was collected from there too. By now, the media was hounding them. A press conference was organized in the CBI headquarters, during which Thicket broke down. After composing himself, he gave a vivid account of the sequence of events. During captivity, he had gradually won the confidence of his abductors, who allowed him occasional strolls on the terrace of the flat in the company of one of the captors. It was during these outings that he had noticed clues connected with the location of the flat, which he kept passing on in Malayalam to his family whenever possible. The kidnappers were initially opposed to his speaking in his native language on the phone, but he had cleverly convinced them that if they wanted the ransom money, they would have to allow him to speak in his mother tongue to his family members, as that was the language they understood best. He had noticed the first clue about the shop with a telephone number 6683899 on a calendar hanging in the kitchen of the flat, a misleading clue which had given the CBI a false start at the beginning of the operation. While addressing the media, Thicket praised the CBI and the special cell of the Delhi police to the skies and said that he was alive because of them. Contrary to expectations, he returned to India to depose during the trial, which led to the conviction of all the surviving accused who were awarded life sentences. It is not common for victims of crime, particularly those based overseas, to return to depose in courts of law in India, which often results in the culprits going scot-free. Thicket, fortunately, proved to be an exception. Operation Desert Safari is easily one of the most thrilling and satisfying experiences of Neeraj Kumar's professional life. He headed a team that had volunteered to take a risky operation in which a private citizen had to be rescued from the clutches of a desperate gang. They were racing against time, and any delays would have proved fatal. Anything that went wrong would have attracted several criticism officially and caused disappointment and regret at a personal level too. Constant inflow of clues about the location of the kidnapper's hideout, that too from the victim himself, added to the uniqueness of this operation. That CBI eventually succeeded in rescuing the hostage from the jaws of certain death and in the process eliminated two of the most wanted criminals of the country added another dimension to their sense of professional and personal achievement. They had also succeeded in preempting an unnecessary fear psychosis in the minds of the NRI community that visiting India for business was unsafe. Incidentally, a list of 25 NRIs was found during the search of the Sarpriviha house along with the satellite phone and four mobiles. Thicket had been told that the gang intended to abduct more NRIs in future in a similar fashion. The case was unique in several ways too. The first information had been lost overseas with the Indian ambassador in Abu Dhabi. The victim, though of Indian origin, was settled abroad and had travelled home to India in search of greener pastures. While kidnapped and held hostage in his home country, his next of kin were to pay ransom in Dubai. As subsequent investigations revealed, the entire conspiracy was the handiwork of criminals based abroad. All told, it was a classic case of transnational organized crime, tackled with the urgency and the finesse it required. The response to the challenge posed by this case was equally noteworthy. The Indian ambassador knew exactly how to respond to the first information report of the crime lodged with him. Rather than send the complaint through the customary bureaucratic maze, as is usually the practice in diplomatic circles, he cut to the chase by informing the CBI directly. The CBI was equally quick to get its act together and involve the special cell of the Delhi police, who have the requisite expertise and capability to handle such operations. That there was a perfect synergy and understanding between the two teams is a sign of the esprit de coup that still exists in the country's police community. The use of technical data and swift fieldwork were some of the other highlights of the operation. No amount of praise is sufficient for ACP Rajbir Singh, without whose involvement and commitment this operation would not have succeeded. ACP Rajbir Singh, Inspector Mohan Chand Sharma, and Sub-Inspector Mehtab Singh have since passed away. The first falling to a bullet on account of personal enmity and the other two in the line of duty. This podcast is a homage to these brave officers. They were exceptional police officers, the likes of whom are difficult to find today. So this was the episode number 2 of The Crime Clock. I really hope you enjoyed it, and please do check out Neeraj Kumar's book for more amazing information about other operations of the Delhi Police and the CBI, titled Dial D for Dawn, The Inside Stories of CBI Missions. And let me reiterate that this is not a promotion of his book. In fact, I'll be using several others for my future stories. Please subscribe to this podcast if you find it interesting and share the same with your friends. Thank you so much for listening, and I'm Kalyan Kumar.